I want to talk more about this concept of methods. We've kind of introduced this this concept in that we talked about the fact that a program is actually made up of one or more classes. And as we get further along, we'll start to have more classes in our program. Right now, generally, we've been using one class. And then within each class, we have one or more methods. Now, most of our programs to this point have just used the main method. That's one method, but any given program might have 20 or 30 different methods, right? Any different class, I should say. And then we have all these different classes that have their own methods, and we use all of these things interacting together to make the program do what we want it to do in the end. And so as we look a little deeper at this concept of a method, I'm going to go ahead and create a new Java program, and the first thing I do is create a class, so public class method fun. Okay, and then we'll create our method inside the class, and our method is public static void main string args. All right, so we've got here a class and a method. And the main method's kind of a special method because it tells Java exactly where to begin. But once we're in that method, let's say that we wanted to do something like just get the square of a number. Now we can do that easy enough by just saying system.out.println, whoops. And let's say I just wanted to print out the square of 2. So 2 times 2. And then we'll go ahead and compile this and run it. And we get the number 4. Okay. Well, I've said it before that my dad, who's been a programmer for a very long time, has a lot of experience. He talks about the fact that good programmers are lazy. And what he means by that is, I don't want to go to all this trouble of doing 2 by 2. So I'm going to work really hard one time so that I never have to do this again. Now, I'm taking this to an extreme example because this is not, you know, difficult. But if I wanted to make this more flexible so that I could just give any number and it would return, it would give me the square of that. So we've talked about now, all through school, I really didn't like math, and I probably shouldn't admit that, but I still don't to some degree. There are some parts of math that I've found to be pretty fun. I like statistics a lot, for example, but in recently going through a calculus course, I didn't enjoy that. It wasn't something I would do for fun. I think a large part of that is I wasn't taught the way that I think there may have been better ways for me to learn things. And I think that's true with all people. Some people may look at these videos and say, I don't get what he's saying here. But for some people, it might be a good match. And we all have different learning methods. And so I'm trying to teach in the way I know how. But in the math realm, they talk a lot about these functions that are black boxes. You pass in something, it goes through a formula and then pops out on the other end. That's in essence what we're going to do with creating a method. So what I'm going to do is create a second method called square. Okay. Now for now, I'm going to say public, which is I guess kind of debatable whether in real life I'd want it to be public or private. This is just an example though. So public, and then this keyword static. Now static, the definition of static is that this method is going to belong to the class instead of belonging to an object that's created from the class. Now, this won't make a lot of sense until we get more into this object-oriented programming idea. But static means that we are it's going to belong to the methodFun class specifically. And that's okay probably in this case. We'll address this later on as we get to object-oriented programming, but for now, let's go ahead and keep that static keyword. And then void, we'll talk about in a second, how about that? And then I'm just gonna create a method called square. Okay, so a public static void square. And then I have some opening closing parentheses. So this is kind of the elements of every method that we're gonna create. It needs to be public or private. Now, if I don't put anything, it defaults to public. Okay, but I'll go ahead and leave that in there. So public, static, void, square, parentheses. We have to have all of these elements when it comes to a method. Okay. And the default, if I don't have static, is that it's not static. So sometimes we'll see methods without static keyword, and sometimes we'll see it without the public keyword. Sometimes we see methods created like this, just void square parentheses. But these elements need to be there, and these elements are just assumed if we don't put them. Does that make sense? So we have these specific elements, whether it's public or private, static or non-static, void or otherwise, the name of the method, and then some parentheses. Now, what goes inside the parentheses? What goes in the parentheses is the information that I'm going to require in order for you to use this method. And so if I'm going to square a number for you, what do I need to know? Well, I have to know which number it is you want to square. And so I like to think of this these parentheses as kind of a portal. In fact, the example that just came to mind, I probably shouldn't even use this, but this happens sometimes when you go into the doctor and they want a urine sample. And then the whole process is very degrading, right? So you take this urine sample that you've collected, hopefully in a very clean manner, and you take, and there's like a little metal door, and you set this urine sample in the door, and you shut the door, you twirl the little thing, and then the urine sample goes somewhere. All right? It goes somewhere through the door, you don't know what happens to it, and then later on you get your results from the urine sample. So think of this. I got to think of better examples than this. As a door. We're saying you need to pass us this information, although this is on the receiving end. So this is the bad end to be in the urine sample world. This is what is being passed to us. So in other words, if I'm getting a urine sample, I have to say, you pass me in a urine sample, and then I can run the analysis. In this case, I'm going to define what's passed in. And what's being passed in if I'm going to do a square? Well, I'm going to do a square as a number, right? I need a number in order to be able to do the square of the number. So I have to decide what kind of number do I want. In this case, I'll just get an integer. So the very first thing that I put is the type of information that's coming in. So I'm going to say there's an integer that I want you to pass in when you call this method. And then I'm going to give it a name on my end. I don't care what you've called it on your end. On my end, I want to give it a name, and I'm going to call it the number. Okay? So I have now defined that whenever you call the square method, you have to pass me an integer into this method, and I'm going to call it number on my end. Okay? So, now that I have that number, I can do something with it, okay? And all I need to do is I'll define another integer, and I'll call this the result, and I'll set that equal to 0 initially, and then I'm going to take and set the result equal to number times number. Now, could I have just said int result equals number times number? Yes, I could have. And this is just the way that I program. I try to program in a very clear way and just keep everything consistent. And so I'm going to define the variable up front, initialize it, and then set it in a result. Okay? So they've passed in, let's say, a 2. A 2 is what comes through the little door. And I say, okay, so I'm going to take the 2 times the 2 and take that result and store it in result. Now the problem is, how do I get the results back to them? After the little urinalysis, they give you a little sheet of paper that's delivered to you that has the information about whatever it is that you're trying to find out. The whole process is very odd. So how do I get that information back to whoever calls this method? Because eventually the way this is going to work is I'm going to say system.out.println, and I want to print. Well, I'm not even going to do that yet. Let's slow it down a bit. I'm going a little too fast. Okay, so let's create an integer called the squared number. And I'm going to set it equal to 0 to begin with. So eventually what I want to do with this is to take and call this square method, and I want to store it in this squared number. So squared number is going to be equal to something. And the way that it works, the method, we say square is the name of the method. So I'm going to say square, and then in the parentheses I have to pass it something. So if I'm passing the 2, then that's how I do it. I say, I'm going to give you a 2. Okay? And then what I want you to do, meaning the method, is to give back the result of the square. So square 2 is going to make something, and then I want you to pass me back that result so I can store it in this number. And then what I'm going to do after I've stored it is to print out what's in the squared number variable. Okay? Now if I compile and run this, okay, I'm getting an error that says incompatible types. And the problem is that I was hoping it would run and do nothing. It's worse than that. I should have thought of this. The problem is, this is what I was getting at, we have to somehow get this result back to this method so that it goes into this number. Now, how do we do that? Well, that's what this little void slot is for. In the void slot, we define what goes back. So this is what we're going to pass back. What type of information we're going to pass back. We could pass back a double. We could pass back a string. We can pass back whatever we want. In this case, we've got an integer that we want to pass back. So instead of having that void keyword there, I'm going to pass back an integer, an int. Okay. This defines the type of information that's going to be passed back. But to actually pass it back now, if I try to compile this, it's going to say missing a return statement. Because in order to pass back, I have to use this keyword, return, and then return what is it that I'm going to return. In this case, I'm returning the result that's been calculated. Okay? And now this method should work. Let me try running it. So I pass in a 2, I get out a 4. I pass in a 3, I get out, hopefully, get out a 9. I pass in a 10, and I should get out a 100, right? And there it is. So what's happened now is instead of completing this calculation, which I could have done inside this main method, I've now created a separate method. This method is a public static method in this case that is called square. I need you to pass me in an int, and I'm going to return to you an int. So in the program, I call the square method, I pass it the int that it wanted, it does the calculation, puts it in result, and then returns the result, which sets it equal to this number, and then that number is printed out. And that is the concept of how a method works. Now we'll talk a little bit more about it, but that is the basic concept of how a method works. All right? Spencer out.